So, I just pray that your hearts are open to the Word of God today, okay? Sometimes our hearts are open and our minds are closed, okay? I'm finding less and less profitable use for my brain when it comes to spiritual things, because it usually interferes with me, okay? That's not to say that we Christians are stupid. It's to say that we Christians are led by the Spirit of God, and God's Spirit speaks to us, and it says that these things that He speaks to us are spiritually discerned, spiritually understood. They're not understood by the natural mind. The natural mind can't make heads or tails out of miracles, okay? And don't expect it to. It's not made for that. Your natural mind is very useful for keeping your heart pumping. It's very useful for figuring out how to, fix your car or something. For spiritual things, you just need to tell that thing to stay in its place, okay? So I want you to open up your hearts today and receive a message that is for you. A lot of people will like to sit in their pew and say, this message is for you, not for me. This message is for everybody who calls himself a Christian. So here's the title of my message today. What do Christians do? That's a question. What do Christians do? Now, I call myself a Christian. Does anybody here call themselves a Christian? Raise your hand. Look at that. At least 70% of you call yourselves a Christian. That's really awesome. What we call ourselves is really irrelevant if what we call ourselves has no bearing on how we live our lives. Right? Anybody can call themselves a Christian, can't they? You know? I'm sure I could teach a parrot to call himself a Christian. Okay? Probably isn't a Christian, though. So there have been a number of people in mental institutions who have claimed to be Jesus Christ, by the way. Or Napoleon, or an alien from another planet. But their claims really were without any verifiable proof. We want to call ourselves Christians, but we want to have proof that we really are. Okay? There should be some evidence there that you really are. Okay? I can call myself a brain surgeon, but you probably wouldn't let me operate on you, would you? Hey, I'm a brain surgeon. Let me do it. Let me take care of that. Okay? I can call myself the smartest man in the world, the fastest runner, the greatest mathematician, and I'm definitely not that. Okay? The wisest man on earth or the most interesting man in the world, perhaps. But anyway. But if I were to call myself any of those things, certainly you would want to see some proof, right? Otherwise, that's just talk. Talk is cheap, isn't it? It really is cheap. Talk is cheap. You know, they say talk is cheap. It's cheap as far as giving it out. But boy, can it pay you back big time sometimes, right? Talk can be very expensive at times, right? But you got to mean what you say, say what you mean. You got to say the truth. So when I was a little boy, not so many years ago, as far as eternity is involved, okay? I remember that we used to sing a song. My mom would sing a song with me, Old MacDonald. Do you remember Old MacDonald? Is there anybody here that doesn't know Old MacDonald? Look at that. Excellent. Okay, so it was a fun song for children to sing, but it also had a lesson built into it. It went something like, Old MacDonald had a farm. Remember that? Old MacDonald had a farm, E-I-E-I-O. I don't know what that spells, but E-I-E-I-O. Okay, and on his farm he had some pigs, E-I-E-I-O. Okay, with an oink oink here and an oink oink there an oink, there an oink, everywhere an oink oink. You remember that part?
Yeah.
That's what pigs do. Okay. Old MacDonald had a farm, E-I-O, okay, and then it went on to a duck, and a duck had a quack, quack here, and a quack, quack there, quack there, quack everywhere, quack, quack. And then a turkey had a gobble, gobble here, and a gobble, gobble there, everywhere a gobble, gobble. Okay, that's harder to say because two syllables. Then a cow had a moo-moo here and a moo-moo there, everywhere, you know, all that stuff. And a mule had a hee-haw. See, you didn't know all these verses were there, but they're there. Yeah, I had to look that up. I want to make sure I quoted it correctly. A mule had a hee-haw here and a hee-haw there. Here a hee-haw, there a hee-haw, everywhere a hee-haw. And a dog had a bow-wow here and a bow-wow there, you know, all that stuff. So what this taught children was how to identify animals by the sound the animal made, didn't it? Right? You go, oh, pig goes oink, got it. And a duck goes quack, okay, I'm getting it. So most animals are honest except for certain birds, okay? Certain birds can imitate anything, but most animals just speak their own language, okay? Pigs usually don't sound like cats, okay? Pigs don't meow, all right? Dogs don't hee-haw like a mule, okay? Horses don't make a sound like an elephant. They usually make the sound that indicates, you know, what they actually are. However, people are a whole nother story. People can make all kinds of noise about what they are, and they can be something completely different. Have you ever found that out? Have you ever found some people are just insincere? Insincere is just a nice way of saying they're complete liars, right? So a lot of people can say a lot of things. Now, most ducks don't meow, most pigs don't quack, the ones I know. So when I was a little boy, my mother would ask me the question. And the question was just kind of a test again. It's like, I'm going to rehearse this test with you. A little review. So here's a review. What does a duck do? Well, a duck goes quack, quack here and a quack, quack there. What does a dog do? A dog goes bow, wow here and bow, wow there. What does a pig do? A pig goes oink, oink here and oink, oink there. And she'd say, that's right. That's right. You got it right. Now, before I ever visited a farm, I knew what the sound of a pig would be. And when I heard that sound, I knew it wasn't a chicken. Okay? Because when I heard oink, 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 I said, that's not a chicken. That's a pig. I know because Mom taught me the song. And pigs make the oink, oink sound. Chickens do a whole different thing. Okay. So here are a few similar questions that we could ask that are kind of like those questions. What sound does a pig make? What sound does a dog make? All these. Here's a question. What do birds do? Well, you could say all kinds of things birds do. Okay? And some of them we won't talk about. But birds fly. Birds fly. Right? So what do birds do? Well, birds fly. Oh, good, good. What do fish do? Fish swim. Oh, that's good. What do trees do? They leave. Exactly. Okay. So anyway, what do Christians do? Oh, now that takes some time, doesn't it? Oh, better answer this one right, because I'm supposed to be one of those. Sounds like thunder. God's trying to get this message across. What do Christians do? Okay. So that's not so easy to answer. So how about this? In your experience, what do Christians do? Well, that's a scary question to ask. I suppose it depends on your experience, doesn't it? Yeah. So some people might say, Christians go to church on Sunday. That's interesting because I haven't yet found that verse in the Bible. The Christian shall be the one that goes to church on Sunday. I found that there are lots of non-Christians that go to church on Sunday too. How about that? Okay. I find that even the devil attends church on Sunday many times. Yeah. Usually he hitches a ride with somebody else, but he gets here. What do Christians do? Some would say Christians read their Bible, or they have rummage sales and sing hymns and chicken dinners, and you know. And they don't drink, they don't smoke, they don't gamble, they don't cuss, they don't watch dirty movies. And they don't date people that do, right? That's what Christians do. I could say that about some people that don't even know Christ. Some people have very moral lives, but they don't know Christ. So that can't be just how you define a Christian. So how can we answer the question, what do Christians do? Well, the first thing we would need to do is to define the word Christian. You know, what does that mean? I want you to look at Acts 11:26. It's going to probably be here. And it says this. Now, I don't really want to necessarily get into the full context of this because all I'm really doing is pulling out one word from this whole thing, maybe two words. Here's what I'm saying. It says, and when he found him, he brought him to Antioch. So for a whole year, Barnabas and Saul met with the church and taught great numbers of people. This is the part I want right here. The disciples were called Christians first at Antioch. That's the part I want. Christians. This is the first time in the Bible that we find the mention that these people, these certain people, are called Christians. They were first called Christians in Antioch. Okay? But you notice I said they were first called Christians. Who were first called Christians? Disciples were called Christians. So I guess you could say in some way there's you could equate a disciple of Christ with Christian, right? Somehow those kind of mean the same thing. Okay, so this was a name that was given to disciples. So what we need to do now is define what a disciple is. Because if we want to define what a Christian is, and we can define it by saying they're a disciple of Christ, we need to find out what's a disciple. Okay, so disciple, the word comes from a Greek word, which is mathetes, which means a learner, a follower of Christ who learns doctrines of Scripture. Now, that could stop there, but that is not where it stops. They learn doctrines of Scripture and the lifestyle they require. Someone who is taught with proper instruction from the Bible, more, with its necessary following through in life application. Oh, so it's not just what you believe, it's also what you do. So, to be a Christian, you're supposed to be a disciple. To be a disciple means that you're learning what Christ taught and you're applying it to your life. So if you're a Christian who learns what Christ taught and doesn't apply it to your life, that's not who we're talking about here. A Christian is a disciple, and a disciple is a person who learns the teachings of Christ and then applies them to their life. That's a disciple, so therefore that's a Christian. Does that make sense? Okay. So A Christian is not simply based on what a person believes, but it's carried through by what the person also does. Okay? James 2:26, James says this, as the body without the spirit is dead, so faith without works is dead. You can say you got all kinds of faith, but if it doesn't carry it out into your life by your actions, it doesn't mean a whole lot. Okay, now the world believes that. Because when the world sees people that call themselves Christians and they're doing things that are unchristianly, the world says, you're fakes. You're not real Christians. The world says you're hypocrites. You know, you say one thing, but you do another thing. Well, a Christian is a disciple who actually does what they believe. They don't just believe it. They do it too. Okay, James 2:18 says this, but someone will say, you have faith, I have deeds. Show me your faith without deeds, and I will show you my faith by my deeds. What you truly believe deep down is going to be carried out in how you live your life. Okay? All right? So the question that we've been asking is not, what do Christians say? Because they could say all kinds of stuff. The question is not what Christians believe, because they can believe all kinds of stuff. That's not where the focus is. The question is, what do Christians actually do? Okay? We are saying that we are followers of Christ sometimes who don't follow Christ. I'm a Christian, a follower of Christ, but you don't do what he did. Well, that's okay. I'm still a believer. That's not the way the Bible defines it. What you do is the strongest outward evidence of what you truly believe. There are people who say they believe the Bible and yet do the opposite of what it says. Their faith is one of words only, but we need to put our money where our mouth is. Does that make sense? Okay. All Christians believe that they are forgiven for their sins, and yet some ignore what the Bible clearly states. Now, this is a particular scripture that I have such great difficulty, frustration with how people deal with this scripture. Okay? Jesus said it. Jesus himself, the Son of God, said this. He said, Matthew 6:15, but if you do not forgive others their sins, your Father will not forgive you your sins. If you do not forgive others, your Father will not forgive you. But there's a whole bunch of people walking around with a whole bunch of unforgiveness who say, I'm forgiven. It's not what Jesus said. There's a lot of people that think they can harbor bitterness. They can hold on to bitterness. It takes me time to forgive. Oh, give me a break. It takes you time to heal. It doesn't take you time to forgive. Forgiveness is a choice you make. And Jesus says, make the choice. Don't wait around. There's a lot of Christians walking around with bitterness, walking around with unforgiveness. Now, you might think I'm slapping Christians right now. I'm saying, hey, save yourself. Save yourself from all the pain, all the misery, all the bondage, all the demonic oppression that comes with hanging on to unforgiveness. Amen. Jesus said, if you don't forgive men, you don't get forgiven. Oh, you know what? So I surrender. Jesus, I give it all up. I forgive everybody. But what if they didn't apologize? He didn't say they had to apologize. You see, sometimes it's unilateral. You make the choice. You know what? You can be a jerk, but I'm going to forgive you anyway. Yeah. So anyway, what do Christians do? Well, I'll tell you one thing Christians do. They forgive people. That's one of the things Christians do. So, Jesus himself said that, not me. Now, what do Christians do? I think that we're ready to begin to answer this now in an accurate way. Christians are, first of all, as we said, they are disciples of Christ. All right? Can we agree to that? Christians are disciples of Christ. Disciples of Christ are those who have both embraced the teachings of Christ and they have altered their life's walk to follow in the footsteps of Jesus Christ. They are not the people who say they have embraced Christ but are going to do their own thing. They are the people who have embraced Christ and follow Christ. That's what the Bible says a Christian is. So what do Christians do could be answered very correctly by saying this. Christians do what Jesus did. Because we're supposed to be following him. So if he's doing something, you know, you remember that old game Simon Says, you know, Simon Says, do this, do that, do this. And you do it all. Well, you have to do what Simon says. Otherwise, you're not playing the game here right. Okay? Well, if you say I'm a Christian, it means you do what Jesus did. And Jesus did it first so he could give us an example of how to do it, didn't he? Okay. In light of that truth, where do we stand? Where do you stand? I guess the thing to do now is to determine what did Jesus do and to decide whether I'm doing that. Once Jesus went up to the temple, and he was given a scroll to read, and the scroll was the book of Isaiah. And he read that scroll out loud. And this is the scroll, this is what it said, Luke 4:18 and 19. The Spirit of the Lord is on me, because he has anointed me to proclaim the good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom to prisoners and recovery of sight to the blind and to set the oppressed free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. And after reading that, Jesus declared that every one of those scriptures was speaking about him. He said, I'm the one that scripture is talking about. Okay? So what he was stating there was something he was sent to do. He was sent to do several things as are detailed in that scripture. He was sent to proclaim the good news or the gospel. He was sent to proclaim freedom to prisoners. He was sent to restore sight to the blind. He was sent to set the oppressed free. He was sent to proclaim the season of the Lord's favor upon man. That's what Jesus did. And what else did Jesus do? 1 John 3:8 says this. The one who does what is sinful is of the devil, because the devil has been sinning from the beginning. The reason the Son of God appeared was to do something, to destroy the works of the devil. So Jesus destroyed the works of the devil. Jesus came to do something. He came to destroy the works of the devil. And the Bible tells us clearly what the works of the devil are. And all of the works of the devil that we're talking about are those works by which he has assaulted man. Man has been the target of all of his evil works, okay? And these things include the lies and deception that the enemy has put on people to blind them from the truth. This includes the sickness and disease that the devil has put upon mankind to plague him. This includes the bondage and oppression that the devil has put upon mankind to bind him. And Jesus was sent to destroy all of those things of the enemy and to help people be set free. Okay? Okay. Jesus was against all those things. Jesus destroyed all those things. Well, that's certainly what Jesus did, but he doesn't certainly expect you and me to do that, does he? Yes, he does. So John 20, verses 19 through 21, Jesus has died, been resurrected, and they're all together in a room praying. It says, on the evening of the first day of the week, when the disciples were together with the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and said, peace with you. After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw it was the Lord. He proved who he was. God has no problem proving who he is if you're open to it. Again, Jesus said, peace be with you. And then he gave them a bombshell. He said, hey, by the way, you know, I was sent to destroy the works of the devil. I was sent to give the blind sight. I was sent to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord. I was sent to set the captives free. By the way, I got news for you. As the Father sent me, I'm sending you. That's what he said, didn't he? I'm sending you to do the same thing I was sent to do. Really? You're sending us to do what you did. Well, you might think that's just probably the 12. It's not just the 12, it's everybody. But anyway, we'll learn that. So these disciples were, after all, you know, they had a higher calling than us. They're the 12 that were with him, or the 11 anyway, that were with him side by side, and certainly they have a higher calling than you or I. All right, so Matthew 28, 16 through 20. I'd like you to focus on this verse for a minute. Matthew 28, 16 through 20. It says, then the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. When they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. Then Jesus came to them and said, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. All means all, doesn't it? Okay. Therefore, I have marching orders for you guys. Go and make disciples. Make Christians. Disciples of Christ. Of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them. Teaching who? The disciples. The people that are after the apostles. All the rest of the folks. Teaching all the rest of the folks who get converted and become Christians. Teaching them what? To obey everything I've commanded you. But, you mean we have the same commands that the apostles had? Yes, exactly. He didn't say, teach them and tell them to obey everything that I commanded you except those special orders I gave you to go out and preach the gospel. No, actually he said, everything I've commanded you to do, tell them to do the same stuff. Really? And surely I'm with you always to the very end of the age. Jesus commanded the apostles to do some things. What did he command them to do? He said, go and make disciples of all nations. If it should have stopped with the apostles, then none of us today should care about going to any nation and making any more disciples because the apostles are dead. But he said, I want you to make disciples, and then I want you to tell them to do what I told you to do. So that will go on in perpetuity until I return. And so the apostles are all dead, and guess who has to do their work now? Disciples. Disciples. It didn't say make other apostles who will have this special commission to do this special job. It says just make disciples, followers of Christ, and tell them to do what I told you to do. Now that's what it says, isn't it? Okay. So he said, here's what I'm telling you to do. Go to all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them. So the disciples got to teach the next disciples to obey everything he commanded us to do. If that command was only for the first apostles, we shouldn't care about outreach or evangelism at all. Because, you know, when they died, it's over. Nobody has to go out. Nobody has to preach. Nobody has to get converts. That's all over. But his command to them was go and do what I've been doing and then teach others to do the same thing. Let's not forget that Jesus instructed these same apostles to teach every new disciple to obey what they have received from Jesus himself. So what else did Jesus do? What did he tell them to do? Because what he told them to do has a great bearing on what he's telling us to do today. Okay? In Matthew 10, he gave his disciples some marching orders. In Matthew 10, 7 through 8, he says, as you go, proclaim this message, the kingdom of heaven has come near. You see, one of the things God wants us to all do, because we're disciples, we're followers of Christ, he wants everybody here to proclaim the kingdom of God is at hand. It's near you. It's within reach. In other words, salvation is there for you to take. It's for you. He wants us to be able to do that. You may say, I'm not an evangelist. Oh, you are an evangelist. Because everywhere you go, it says that we are written epistles, read note of every man. Everywhere you go, you have a testimony. Everywhere you go, your testimony can be the life you live, the things that you do, because Christians do certain things, okay? And as people see you, they say, I have a question for you. What is the hope of your calling? Why do you do these things? How come you don't seem bothered by the economy when everybody else does? How come you're not worried about earthquakes taking out your home and everybody else is worried? How come? It says, be ready to give an answer to anybody, right? Okay, so he said this, Matthew 10, 7 through 8, as you go, proclaim this message, the kingdom of heaven has come near. And then he said this, oh my goodness, he said this to you. Heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse those who have leprosy, drive out demons. Freely you have received, freely give. When Jesus said, freely you have received, freely give, you have to understand the fact that you believe you've only received a little bit is your problem. It's not the truth. Okay? You did not receive the Holy Spirit, Junior. You did not receive the Holy Spirit light. Okay? You know, like some of those programs you can buy, you know, programs for your computer. This is the light version. It has less functionality. Oh, no, you have the Holy Spirit. You have the Spirit of the Almighty God within you. And therefore, you can freely give because His supply is endless. You have one Christian who's acting in faith. One Christian, this is a fact. One Christian has the potential in himself, because he has the Holy Spirit, to heal every single sick person on earth. One Christian. One Christian has the power within himself, because he has the Holy Spirit, to cast every demon in every person on the face of the earth. He has that potential within him. So as much as you give out in your lifetime, you're never going to give it all out. Freely you've received. He didn't give it to you sparingly. He didn't give it to you grudgingly. He gave it to you liberally so that you couldn't run out. You can give it away and give it away. You could be like Bill Gates giving out $1 bills. How long do you suppose he could give out $1 bills? It'd be forever. Okay? You can do that with what God has given you. And he said, here's some of the things I've given you. Go out, proclaim the gospel, heal the sick, cleanse the leper, raise the dead. Really? Me? Well, he said, do all things that I've commanded, teach them to do all things I've commanded you. You might say, well, that's just for the elite. That's for the first 12. That's not for the average follower. But I want to remind you of something. During Jesus' lifetime, not after his death, before his death, before he made the sacrifice on the cross, before he made the atonement for sins, before the Holy Spirit was resident within the believer, before any of that happened, he took 72 regular guys and said, I give you authority. Go out there and heal people and cast out demons. Now, that was to 72 people who didn't have the Holy Spirit in them, 72 people who had not could not say, I'm saved by Christ's sacrifice, because it hadn't happened yet, but they had the authority given to them. How much more by you who not only have the authority, but you have the Holy Spirit, the power of God in you, in a limitless supply. So the 72, what did he say to the 72? He said this to 72 people, regular people. He said, heal the sick who are there. And some versions say 70, some say 72. He says, heal the sick who are there and tell them the kingdom of God has come near to you. So he gave these first believers two things to go out and do. He said, look, you don't have to take a purse with you and a bunch of money with you. You don't have to take a change of clothes with you. But I'll tell you what I want you to take with you. I'm going to supply you with everything you need. And here's what you need. You need to take the gospel, the good news, that Jesus Christ has shown up on the scene and he's the Savior of the world. And then you take the other thing with you, which is this, the power of God to heal the sick, deliver the oppressed. And guess what? He's sending you out. And he's not sending you out with no utility belt. He gives you the same equipment. He's sending you out with the same power that he sent them out. In fact, it's greater because you have the endless supply within you. Now, I never heard a story in the Bible where any of these 72 or 70, whichever you want to look at the versions, and where any of these 72 ever came back and said, you know, my name's, you know, Bob the Apostle, and it didn't work for me. I didn't see that. They all came back and said, wow, we're amazed. What you said we had, and we did it, and it worked. Right? Luke 10:17 says this. The 72, by the way, Luke, it says the 72, returned with joy and said, Lord, even the demons submit to your name. Even the demons submit to your name. He replied, I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven. I've given you, all of you, authority to trample on snakes and scorpions and to overcome some of the power of the enemy, all of the power of the enemy, and nothing will harm you. Do you realize you have that and more? You do. I don't feel it. Well, the fact you don't feel it doesn't mean you don't have it. There are some people who have AIDS who don't feel a thing, but they still got it. Well, you've got the power of the Holy Spirit, whether you feel it or not. Okay? All right. Okay, so we can believe that he gives such power to 72 and he gives such power to 12, but what about you and me? What about us, just the regular people now? Mark 16:15-18. He said to them, go into all the world, preach the gospel to all creation. Here it is. Whoever, I'm a whoever, you're a whoever. Whoever believes, that's me, I believed. And is baptized, I got baptized. And is saved, that's the whoever. Or whoever believes and is baptized will be saved. That's me. That's me. And these signs will accompany those whoever's, those who believe. That's me. That's you. In my name, they will drive out demons. They will speak with tongues. They will pick up snakes with their hands, and when they drink a deadly poison, it will not hurt them at all. They will place their hands on sick people, and they will get well. Those signs follow the whoever's, which you are, the whoever's. John 14:12. Verily, I tell you, whoever believes in me will do the works I've been doing, because isn't that what Christians do? They do what Jesus did. And they will do even greater things than these because I'm going to the Father. We're even supposed to be doing more. I'm a whoever, you're a whoever. So what do Christians do? Well, they follow Christ and live a life that reflects his teachings, don't they? Yes, but there's a couple other things they do. More specifically, what do Christians do? They proclaim the good news of the kingdom of God. They heal the sick. They deliver the oppressed from the devils. That's what Christians do. Wow, can I really do that? The greatest blockage to walking in the fullness that God has given you is the blockage that lies between your ears. That's the blockage from you flowing in the Spirit. But my mind says, I don't think I quite grasp that. Don't depend on that thing. My mind says, that doesn't make sense. I've never experienced that yet. Of course you've never experienced that yet. Your mind has shut you off to it. You need to get that thing out of the way and believe what God said. You see, Christians believe what God said, not what their head said. Okay? If you get a revelation of who you really are and what you've really been given, then you can begin to walk in this. It can become a reality in your life today. You don't have to work your way up to it. Okay? You can start today because you've already got it in you. You've already got the Holy Spirit in you. Many are just satisfied with their spiritual life. The surest way to find satisfaction is this. Find out what you were made to do and begin to do that. You see, if you're an artist and you're finishing concrete, there's something in you that's dissatisfied with what you're doing. Oh, man, I got to make money, but oh, this is not what I really want to be doing, right? If you're an engineer and you're flipping hamburgers, there's something in you that's not satisfied with what you're doing, right? If you're a Christian, guess what? You will never be satisfied as long as you are not doing what you were made to do. And you were made to go out into the world to proclaim the word of God, to heal the sick, to deliver the oppressed, to give sight to the blind. You. Every whosoever. So you go, I haven't experienced that. Well, of course you haven't, because you need to go out and do it. You see, like I said before, I would like to skydive, but I'm afraid of jumping out of a plane. Once I'm out of the plane, I'd be fine. Okay? So if you push me out of a plane, I'd enjoy myself. All right? But the thing is you got to go that first step. You got to take that first step. And when you take that first step and you get a little taste of it, you'll never go back. Okay? So I think I said this earlier, but Matt came for prayer time last Wednesday. And Matt had seen a couple of these videos on YouTube where I was praying for people. And Matt says, Tom, I want that kind of boldness. I want to do that. But I'm shy or I'm afraid or I'm timid. I don't know how to approach people, that kind of thing. I said, Matt, I got a cure for you. Come with me. I was like, well, today? I can't do it today. But he goes, well, I can do it tomorrow. I said, okay, Matt, we'll do it. So on Thursday, Matt and I went down to Northgate Mall, okay? First thing we see is a woman in a wheelchair, and she has no kneecap and one knee, and she's on her way to an appointment to get for her surgery. She's got pain, 9 out of 10 pain. And Matt's there. I said, Matt, you're the cameraman. I said, we're going to take all that pain away, lady. Really? All that pain away, you're not going to feel any more pain. You're going to be able to stand up. And anyway, long story made short. She stood up. There was no pain. She was rejoicing. Is that true, Matt?
Oh, yeah. She was so happy. She's like, hey, well,
yeah. So then we find another person, and this person has back pain for 14 years. Guess what? We pray for them, and Matt's the one who approached this person. We pray for that person. The pain goes away, and you know what? Now Matt's hooked. Matt says, Tom, can we go out every week? Can we do that again? I guarantee you do this once, you'll be hooked. Because this is what you were made to do. And when you're not doing what you're made to do, you're unsatisfied. So many of us are like fish trying to live our lives on dry ground. Okay? It's difficult to live in a world of dry ground when you're a fish, okay? We find it difficult to travel on the soil with only the assistance of our flippers and fins, right? We feel kind of dry. You ever feel dry as a Christian? And unlively, okay? We find it's hard to do normal things. Even taking a deep breath is difficult because you're a fish out of water, and you're never going to be satisfied if you're a fish out of water. So Ephesians 2:10 says this about you. It says, for we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. In other words, God made you to do these things I'm talking about. I want to give you some clear guidance here. I want to inform you that you are a fish who's been trying to make the best thing you can out of life, out of your natural element. And it's time to listen up and jump in the water. It's time to jump in. When you begin to experience life in the water or the Spirit of God, you're going to begin to realize that's what you were made for. You're going to swim like a bird glides through the air. You're going to glide through that water, okay? You're going to feel freer than you've ever felt. You're going to never feel dry again, never gasping for air again, never parched and thirsty spiritually, but you're going to find contentment because you are in the element you were designed to be in. Out there in that sea of humanity, right? Fisher of men, find another fish and introducing them to the head fisherman, right? Jesus Christ, and telling them about their new life that he has made for them. Now, I'm a living testimony of this today. Once I accepted who I am in Christ and what he has given me, my whole world changed. Now, I'm not talking about when I got saved. I'm talking about recently, okay? Beginning in February, the Lord opened my eyes to some things. He did not appear to me in a vision. He did not send me a message through angelic visitation. He did not send a prophet to declare it over me. He just showed me the truth that was always there that I hadn't seen. That's all it was. That opened up the world, okay? You may be asking, what do I do now? Well, do what a Christian does, okay? That's what I do now. I go out into the world. I proclaim the kingdom of God through our Savior Jesus Christ. and I heal the sick and deliver the oppressed through the power of Jesus Christ that's in me, that's in you too. You see, anything I can do, you can do. Better, right? Okay. The fish is in the water now, and the water is great. I'm inviting you to come on in, okay? I'll be teaching classes and then taking you out to experience this in real life. And it will wake you up spiritually like nothing you've ever experienced before. Now, Matt was awakened. Matt is alive. Wherever we went from that point on, Matt's looking. How about them? How about them? How about them?
And you notice that the world, they cover themselves up with anger and fear.
Yeah.
And we break that.
Yeah. And you see, the thing is you might say, well, you're doing that. Maybe you're doing that for your own kicks, your own glory. Oh, I get benefit out of it. I guarantee it. But the thing is, what benefit? What great benefit it is to see somebody who's been bound for years completely set free just because you stepped out of your comfort zone for a minute? What a payoff. How awesome. People crying, people weeping, people falling over. You say, oh, thank you that you stopped me today and talked to me. Thank you that you delivered me today. I've been, for years and years, this young man that came first service, the Lord told me his age, I didn't even know, he's 38. Yeah, he's 38. Anyway, so the Lord told me he's 38. Anyway, and this guy came and he said when he was born with a club foot and they had to do surgery and straighten his foot up. But when they did that, his leg never grew out right and his leg was short. And he said, I saw one of your videos. You're praying for people. Can you pray for me? I go, sure, I can pray. Took him off in the prayer room over there and his leg grew right out. His leg is the same length. He had heels, inserts in his shoe, lifts. Take those out now. He's been going 38 years thinking this will never change. He said, I can live with it. I'll work with it. It's got a lot of pain, too, pain in his ankle and stuff. He had a lot of pain. He said, I can live with this. I can get by. But Jesus said, no, today's your day to be completely delivered of that. Nothing's impossible for him. All you got to do is step out of your comfort zone. Step out of your boat, okay? And Jesus will support you. It's not the matter that you are so mighty and so powerful. It's that he is so mighty and so powerful. You got to change the way you think. You got to change the way you see things. Okay? This will supercharge your faith. Not only once you get a taste of this, I don't have to worry about people. This is like something. I give you one free sample of this. If you go out and do this once, I can just turn you loose because you're going to be hooked. Hooked. After you do this once, you're hooked. From then on, your life gets richer and richer because you want to see more and more people delivered. You want to get closer and closer to the Savior that's in you, right? You want to get farther and farther away from the sin that you've been fighting with. Suddenly it has no power. It has no control because you have all the power in you. And you can feel the power of God moving through you in a great way. And you decide, you know, why have I been living beneath my privilege? I've had this on board the whole time, right? I've had the Holy Spirit in me this whole time. It'll supercharge your faith. It'll deepen your commitment. It'll make you feel closer to your Savior. You don't have to be gifted because you've got the Holy Spirit's gift. You see, you've got the gift of the Holy Spirit. You can say, well, I don't have the gift of healing. It says, these signs shall follow them that believe, not them that believe and have the gift of healing. Just them that believe, they'll lay their hands on the sick, they'll recover. You have it in you. Well, I've never seen it that way. That's the blockage between your ears that's telling you. We need to turn around and say, you know what? Let God be true. Let everybody be a liar, including my own brain. If God said it, I'm going to believe it. Right? If God said it, who am I to argue with it? If he said it, I'm just going to do what he said. And he said, I've given every single one of you, everyone that's called a disciple, everyone that came after the apostles that got the same commandments that the apostles were given, every one of you, he said, I've called you to go out to preach the gospel, to heal the sick, to give sight to the blind, to deliver the oppressed in my name. Why? So that he will gain much glory. Much glory. You see, there used to be a day back in the 50s where there were these super evangelists who had these healing ministries and their name was up in lights. Today is a day God is doing a new thing. It's a new miracle. He's going to raise up everybody. There's not going to be any one name they can look at but Jesus Christ. That's the only name. So he doesn't want me to be some superstar healer. He wants all of us to be superstars for his sake. And everybody can do it. You will provide yourself, your body, as transportation for the Holy Spirit as you approach the lost. But he will supply all the power it takes to minister to them. Okay? And in the end, everybody's lives will be changed, including yours. Now, I know some are afraid of the thought of reaching out to others. But at least you owe it to yourself to learn what to do if the occasion arises. You know, you may say, well, I don't know if that's kind of scary stuff, reaching out to strangers to pray for the sick. Well, guess what? You're going to need to know how to pray for the sick when you're in your home and your husband or wife has a problem. This is good for everybody. Everybody should be walking in this. Jesus sent out his disciples armed with just two things and a mission to change the whole world. And they changed the whole world armed with two things. Okay? The power of God's mighty hand working miracles and the gospel of Jesus Christ. As Jesus sent them, so now he sends you and me. And as he expected them to reach the world, he expects you and I to reach the world. Can we do this? Do you realize if there was just half of you today, half of you, who said, I'm going to do this, and you began to be like Matt, where everywhere you go, you're looking, and wherever I go, I'm looking. I'm looking for that person that's limping. I'm looking for that person that has an issue and said, hey, can I pray for you, please? And they're getting healed, and they're getting delivered. Do you realize if just half of us did that, the multiplication factor, you'd be making disciples. Because I'm going to tell you what, you might say, it's not all about healing. I'm going to tell you what, I've never seen such a door opener for salvation as healing. Two people last week that I prayed for got saved. Okay? If I had not approached them because of their issue, they never would have heard the gospel. When you touch people with God's power, they start to say, you know, forget about all my thoughts of why maybe this religion's better or that one's better or maybe that's just what you believe. I've seen God work and I know what's real. Right? Changes everything. God wants to work through you. And if just half of you went out and started doing this, you'd get hooked. And then you'd get others hooked. And you get others hooked. And suddenly, there would be talk in the media. Shoreline, something's happening in Shoreline. This whole community, people are getting healed. People are becoming Christians by the droves. We don't understand it. They're in Washington, one of the darkest places on the face of the United States. They're in a place where you got like 1% to 2% of people go to church and all the rest is darkness. And suddenly there's this great light getting brighter and brighter and brighter. And it can be like a wave that radiates out from Shoreline to Seattle to Bellevue to, you know, to Kirkland, all over the place, just simply because a few of us decided to step out of our comfort zone. That's all it takes. That's all it takes. So the classes, July 9th, Wednesday night. Oh, man, I'm going to have to miss Oprah or something. Get your priorities straight, right? July 12th, here. And then we're going to go out. We need you to sign up because we need to know how many people we're going to transport. We're going to take you out. And you go, but I'm afraid. That's okay. Come with somebody that isn't afraid, and we'll get you unafraid real quick. Because once you get a taste of seeing people healed and delivered, you go, can I have some of that? All right? Come and join us. Let's start a revolution. Let's be the people that change this whole state of Washington into a place that is a light. It's a beacon. It's like a lighthouse in this dark nation. When people begin to taste and see that the Lord is good, you won't be able to contain it. Now, that's the end of the message, however. If there's anybody here who has not accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, he wants you in his family, in his kingdom today. He wants to become the Lord of your life. He wants to deliver you from your life of oppression where the devil has run roughshod over you. And he wants to give you a brand new life. So if you've not accepted Jesus, this is a day to get set free. If you've not accepted Jesus, raise your hand because we want to pray for you right now. Anybody? Anybody at all? Anybody at all? Anybody at all? All right then. Bow our heads in prayer. Father, in Jesus' name, Lord, I know that in some people right now, there's fear is causing them to falter in doing this thing. For some, it's a scary thing to do, Lord, but let them know they'll be taken by the hand, Lord, and you will be there, and you will support them, and you will back them up, but Lord, you will bless them like they've never been blessed before. So Lord, just create right now a commitment in every heart to go out and to do what you commanded all of us to do anyway, Lord. We want to do it. We want to be real Christians, Lord. We want to live out, Lord, that life that you designed for us because that's where we are greatly satisfied. That's where we find the greatest joy, the greatest peace, the greatest satisfaction. Just seal that to our hearts today, Lord, and cause us, Lord, to take that leap, to take that jump, to get in the water, Lord. And we thank you for what you're doing right now and for the great, mighty miracle that you are about to work in this area. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. God bless you.